I'm going to make a short presentation of about 20 minutes, and after that we will have a discussion on, I will respond to your questions, because what I'm going to say is going to obviously to raise many, normally should raise many, many, many questions. So this is a short presentation of 20 minutes of geopolitics in about 10 points. My first point concerns the first key of interpretation of the world geopolitics. Why are there conflicts at the present time? How can we explain the war in Ukraine, in Syria, in Yemen, the opposition between Iran and Israel, and most of the conflicts in the world? In order to understand that, we have to take into account the fact that we have an historical opposition in the world between the empires, the monarchies, the powers which have conquered the world thanks to their navy, the Dutch, the British, and later the Americans. These powers have conquered the world and have ensured a world domination thanks to the combination of their navy and their fleet of their commercial fleet. And these powers historically have struggled against empires, France, Spain, the German Empire, Russia, China. So this historical opposition between France and England, between Russia and England, this is the core, this is the root of all conflicts in the world today. So the first key of interpretation is an opposition between the liberal and maritime world of the United States, its allies in Japan, in the United Kingdom, and in Western Europe, and three empires, which historically had a problem. It was difficult for them to have an access to the seas. China fought against the barbarians coming from the north, and that's the reason why they built this great wall. Iran was powerful in the antiquity when it struggled against, when it mastered one half of the Mediterranean. But Iran has been confined by the Russians and the British. And you have an alliance between Iran, China, and Russia. Russia in the 18th century opens two windows on the sea, one window in the north, St. Petersburg, and one window in the south, Odessa. So you see today, with the conflict in Ukraine, we have a second assault of Russia on Ukraine to conquer a liberal window on the sea in the south. That's basically what did Catherine the Great in the 1770s, 1780s. So that's the core opposition. So when you look at Ukraine, when you understand that the British are very active in Ukraine today against the Russians, the reason underlying is, of course, the opposition between the empires of the sea and the empires and the continents. And opposing the United States, you have what we could call the new Mongol Empire, a connection between Russia, China, Iran, and sometimes Turkey. Because Turkey is the key of federation of these different empires. So that's the main key of understanding geopolitics. And the main strategy of the United States during the 20th century was to disconnect the German factory from the Russian reserves of oil and gas. And that's what the United States has done in Ukraine. That's the reason why the US is funding the war in Ukraine, except that the United States might have applied a strategy of the 20th century to a conflict of the 21st century, because obviously the new factory of the world is China and India. And the immediate consequence of the war in Ukraine is that the United States have pushed India in the arms of Russia. And now the two main factories of the world, India and China, are now connected to these main reserves of oil, of raw materials, and of manpower. The second point I wanted to make was about what is underlying geopolitics. Under geopolitics, under these conflicts, you have a geo-economic opposition between the United States and China, and you have a struggle between the dollar, which is frail today, and the yuan, the Chinese yuan, or the electronic yuan, the e-yuan. The Chinese have signed an agreement with SWIFT so that European companies today are able to sell in dollar or in e-yuan. The Chinese have introduced the e-yuan in Iran. Iran has become a financial colony of China. And obviously, investors today are trying to diversify their investments, investing in dollar, but as they know that the dollar is frail, also investing in e-yuan. So behind the curtain of conflicts, you have this geo-economic opposition, which counts much more. If in the next future there was a collapse of the dollar, this would mean the end of the United States. And the most important information we have had in the last months was not war in Ukraine. The most important piece of information was the statement of Mohammed bin Salman in Saudi Arabia, who declared that he could now sell his oil in e-yuan. This obviously, that's a huge change, because obviously the power of the United States since the Second World War rested upon this agreement. You sell your petrol in dollars and we give you a military, we protect you, military speaking. So that's a huge change in the world. My third point is about Ukraine. Ukraine, a state which has never really existed throughout history. It existed in the 9th century, 9th, 10th century, a very artificial state based on, in fact, two regions, one under Russian influence and the other one under Polish influence. When the West wants to weaken Russia, it strengthens Ukraine. Ukraine is a twin of Russia. And all the policy of the United States since the beginning of since the downfall of the USSR was to educate this Ukrainian twin, giving a different education to the Ukrainian twin, so that the Russian youth would, so that they would think about Ukraine as a paradise. Okay, so this is why these two countries are interconnected. When Napoleon I wanted to destroy Russia, his idea was to create a puppet state in Ukraine called La Napoléonide. So that's an old French project of the 17th, 18th, 19th century, which has been reused, and this policy has been taken over by the Germans in the 1930s and later by the United States. In fact, there was a regional movement in Ukraine at the end of the 19th century, like in Provence, like in Bretagne, and this regional movement has given a place to a national state today. So the paradox is that the invasion of Putin's Russia, in fact, has spawned the emergence of a state in Ukraine. Now, what is going to be the consequence of this conflict for the whole world? I would like to say a few words about different regions. If we start by Africa, in Africa, the consequence of the war in Ukraine is, of course, inflation is visible everywhere in the world. The price of food is rising. The price of energy is rising. The Italian, Spanish, German, and French diplomacy have paid visit to certain African states so as to buy cheap energy. Western Europe is relaunching civil nuclear energy. This means that it has become affordable to exploit bauxite minerals in Africa. So we are going to see in 2023 African governments blocking the price of food. Madagascar trying to transform its own sugar. So huge transformations in the area of food and energy, increasing migrations in Africa. And so as French operations are concerned, they were centered on Mali. However, the Russian, Turk, and Chinese operations of influence have shifted the center of gravity of the French military operations in Niger. But Niger is now under the influence of China, exploiting its oil, its mineral reserves. So that's basically for the consequences for Africa. If we look at the Middle East, has remained pretty neutral in the Russian-Ukrainian conflict. You might remember the assassination of General Soleimani, who was an Iranian general a few years ago. In fact, Soleimani was negotiating at that time an agreement between Iran and Saudi Arabia, and that's the nightmare of Israel. In any case, the Saudis do not trust the Americans anymore. The United States is withdrawing from the Middle East. In terms of energy, they are exporting again, so they don't need the Middle East anymore. The Saudis had massively funded the campaign of Donald Trump. They've recently funded a company of Jared Kushner to thank Jared Kushner for his diplomatic efforts when he was the main diplomatic actor for the United States under Trump, or to anticipate the return of Trump, we don't know. The United Arab Emirates have welcomed Bashar al-Assad. The Russians are investing in Emirates in Saudi Arabia. So this Middle East is becoming more and more neutral, looking at China, looking at the United States. And we might see new connections between Iran and Saudi Arabia, despite the old cultural, historical opposition between both nations. In Europe, obviously, Europe is far weaker. The consequence of the conflict is a weak Europe, a second wave of Americanization of Europe. The United States gain the market of real estate in Ukraine, the market of reconstruction of Ukraine. They have bought the soils of Ukraine. Of course, they try to have the monopoly of exporting weapons to Ukraine. The Americans are also selling a civil nuclear plant to Poland in competition with the French. Europe needs energy. It cannot do without the Russian energy. And in fact, the immediate consequence for Europe of the conflict of the war is that recarbonization of Europe, as the Germans don't want nuclear energy, they are exploiting their coal. We are going to see next year a rise of 30% of the production exploitation of coal. So we will be more polluting than ever. The dream of a green transition is over for Europe as long as the war in Ukraine is on. So that's also an important consequence in terms of of climate and ecology. Despite all our efforts, in fact, we are going to exploit the nuclear energy and coal, depending where we are in Europe. So Americanization of the European continent. In this alliance between Russia and China, if the Russians lose the war, they are going to be swallowed by the Chinese. So they have to win the war. They've lost about 20,000-30,000 men, but they have to, in fact, they are gaining slowly land in Ukraine, maybe targeting Odessa, the last window on the sea, and trying to close the Black Sea and privatizing the Sea of Azov. I turn back to my first point, and this big competition between the empires of the sea and the land, that's very important. In fact, it's the British SAS who sunk the Russian admiral ship in Ukraine, and not the Ukrainians. So the special forces are also very active. The Western special forces are also very active in Ukraine, discreetly. So in Asia, the Chinese have gained the Solomon Islands, which belong to the Commonwealth. And so that's an important naval base for the Chinese in the Pacific in order to increase their naval offensive in the Pacific. Sri Lanka had big financial problems because during 2 years, Sri Lanka, because of the COVID, they lost hundreds and thousands of tourists. And Sri Lanka had so important financial problems that China decided to refund Sri Lanka. So Sri Lanka is going to be an island under Chinese domination and maybe a new naval base for China. And that's all the more important that after an operation of influence, the Americans have achieved to regain Pakistan, which was in the hands of the Chinese, in which the Chinese had funded a new naval base for their naval Silk Route. So things are also changing in Asia. The Russians are losing influence in Central Asia. The war between Armenia and Azerbaijan has started again. Israel is supporting Azerbaijan because that's an ideal base to monitor Iran, because Azerbaijan is selling oil to Israel, and Israel sends weapons to Azerbaijan. That's like the former US-Saudi alliance. And obviously, Russia has to win in Ukraine to obtain a partition of Ukraine. Otherwise, it won't be able to be the gladiator of China, of the factory. So in the alliance between the Persian creative brain, the Chinese factory, and Russia has to become the soldier of the empire. And as far as what should be examined next, I think for the new questions for this summer, we have to watch in terms of geopolitics, the new connection between Russia, China, and India. That's very important. Are they going to form? Is Russia going to be a potential arbitrator of the conflicts between China and India? And in terms of economy, we should have a look at the geopolitics of inflation, knowing that the only country which has no inflation today is Russia, because it has no problems. It has reserves of energy and food. And we are going to see the rise of the prices of food and energy. So this was a brief presentation of the main features of today and tomorrow, and so that it was just a sort of starter in order to open the discussion with you. Please, now to your open questions on any subject if I can give you an answer.
Hello, Thomas.
Yes.
Yes, I do have a question. Do you think Europe or France would send soldiers to fight in Ukraine? Is that possible?
Yes. The West sends special forces in Ukraine.
But so far, they just send weapons, right?
That's the official version. Version is that we send weapons, but in order to operate these weapons, we need people, and we have many testimonies of the fact that, in fact, we have special forces operating. You might remember the episode of the Azovstal, where, in fact, it lasted a long time. The reason why it lasted a long time is that the Russians wanted to capture the Israelis, British, maybe French soldiers who were inside. They wanted to have them living in order to exchange them for Russian prisoners. So it's quite obvious that the West is military operating. You have also mercenaries operating, but I think also special forces, because it's not an open war, but it's also important for the West to protect Ukraine and to protect its borders and to stop Russia, to prevent Russia from gaining this window on the sea.
Okay, thank you very much.
Please, you're welcome. Come on, any question?
I have one question regarding the Ukraine war. Do you think that the Russians have the capacity and the will to attack more countries in Europe?
For the time being, they have put into action 80% of their army. They have lost 20 to 30,000 soldiers, which is very important. They put the best forces in the south. The special forces are in the south, and the other ones in the north, where you saw these massacres from a Russian regiment, which was in fact situated near the Chinese border. In the competition between the United States and Russia, it's the fight between the wolf and the dog. The dog, the American dog, is fed with petrol dollars every week. The Russian wolf is not at the center of the world geoeconomics. So it starves, and it has to develop a political intelligence, which is much, much more important than the United States. The United States can lose wars, and in fact, most of the wars of the West have been lost in the last decades. In Afghanistan, we've lost, in Syria, in Libya, we've lost everywhere, in Iraq. You had sometimes military successes followed by political disasters. And this can be explained by the deep disconnection between military action and political strategy. But the Russians, during the same period, developed an important political intelligence, and they always combined power with, you know, war and diplomacy. They were a little bit like Louis XIV, gaining parts of Lorraine and Alsace in the 17th century, territory by territory. So they were very careful, not expanding too much, because they are weak. In fact, many Russians think that Putin has made a mistake. And at the start of the war, there was something very interesting, because he, before entering into Ukraine, There was a video on Russian television and a discussion between Putin and all his ministers, chiefs of intelligence, in which he asked them, well, do you think, what should be the attitude of Russia? Everyone agreed with Putin, but you could see in the every Russian understood in the attitude of the ministers that in fact they were not so much for the war. So it's a step backwards for the Russian diplomacy, and they're really in a big mess. So it's very difficult to anticipate. However, at the beginning of the war, they saw that the Ukrainian army was about to crush the separatist republics. And they thought that with the movement from the north and from the east, they would be able to encircle them and to destroy them. It failed. And after a few weeks, they came back to their old policy, which is a little bit wiser. And I don't think they are yet capable of pushing their fires even further. But they could conquer half of Ukraine, maybe in the long run. But I think what they wish is to be strong on the battlefield, so as to negotiate a diplomatic agreement. They would accept, in fact, they could accept an integration of Ukraine into the EU, but not into NATO. Well, it's difficult to assess what would be the next move, because power is unpredictability. So if you want to be powerful in a company, in an organization, in your country, you have to be unpredictable. Hamlet simulates madness in order to make his inquiry and to discover who has killed his father. That's really something important. Unpredictability is power. And this is why when journalists said that Trump was dangerous because he was unpredictable, this was to me nonsense. He's unpredictable because he's powerful. That's just linked.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
I'm off camera, so I'll try to project. You mentioned the environmental impact that the war will have in the near future with the use of coal and nuclear energy.
Yep.
Are there any current movements occurring that are trying to find other sources, other solutions for this?
I am not an expert of energy, but what I see is that a wind turbine produces energy 24% of the time. It's very polluting, in fact, so it's not yet efficient. We have bet on electric energy, but we must, of course, produce batteries, and that's also polluting, and also produce electricity. So for the time being, I think it's either nuclear energy or the traditional gas, oil, and petrol energy. What is obvious is that we are entering now a phase of recarbonization of Europe, and not only Europe, but many other countries of the world. So we have, it's very a paradox. We are all organizations, companies are advocating, of course, a green transition, because basically that's what is needed. We are in a time of digitalization, the digitalization of the world linked to, of course, which has been accelerated by the COVID episode, brought about a radicalization of cultures, of identities, where you find individuals now who are locked into little bubbles on internet. And that's, in fact, the logic of the market, because the new oil and the new energy of the market is our tastes. So the interest of the market is to put us into little atoms in which we share our tastes with people who have, in fact, similar options. And in order to escape digitalization and radicalization, we want to bring back nature. So that's a real need by every human being in the world, but it's not yet operational. What is true also is that in democracies, if you want to advocate real green transition, then you have you must renounce to one part of our comfort. And what political party is will advocate a partial renunciation to our comfort for the time being? No one. The Americans have lobbied the German Green parties, and they are now pro-war in Ukraine. So that's incredible. But I saw 3 days ago an appeal of German intellectuals to end the war in Ukraine and to find a diplomatic solution, because of the consequences in terms of environment, and also because it is clearly a war without aim, a war without strategy. So that's my response. But I'm not, again, not an expert of in energies. But what I read everywhere is the recarbonization of Europe. And that's, of course, so we are going to produce, we are going to be more polluting than ever. And we are, of course, going to buy our food and our petrol at much higher prices. And this might bring about huge consequences for even the organization of our countries, regions, or work.
Thank you. Thank you for the presentation. I have a question. How long can the war last in Ukraine?
A long time, because the measure of time in the West is not the measure of time of the Russians. They have decided to take that time. It can be a never-ending war, like in Iraq, when we entered into Iraq, when we destroyed the Iraqi state, and were unable, in fact, to install peace in the end. It's very easy to destroy. It's very difficult to rebuild a country. So it could be a never-ending war, a 100-year war, because we are at the borders of the empires. We are at the, and in fact, Ukraine has always been at the borders between the Russian, the Austrian, and the Turk Empire. In fact, when Catherine the Great expands the borders of Russia, it chases away the Turks. So I don't think it will end up quickly. Also, in a time of inflation, in a time during which, in fact, the US is a declining empire, one of the ways to relaunch the economy is to sell weapons. So, you know, the weight of the military industrial arsenal in the United States, they are also leading the economy. So that's also the interest of the United States to have a never-ending war, unfortunately. But this will be done to the detriment of Europe, clearly.
Thank you very much.
I am sure you have not only questions, but as you are here from different, you have different points of view, you're coming from different countries, I am sure you're able to either to add things to confirm or to point out the mistakes of this sketch of 2023, according to what you see in your countries. I did not mention South America, but again, like Asia, South America remained pretty neutral and opportunistic, because most of the countries want to keep a relation with the United States and with China. Colombia was a good ally of the United States, Venezuela of Russia, but for the rest, every country tried to maneuver. And that's a change, that's a huge change. Where are you coming from, Christina? Where are you from, Christina?
I'm from Spain.
Also in the agriculture of the south of Europe, I don't know if you see changes in Spain, but the Italians who were dependent on Ukraine and Russia for the production of noodles. They exported 60% of their wheat. They have transformed 500,000 hectares of tomatoes into wheat. So the agricultural production is also changing. And I suppose that you also feel the first impact of inflation upon Spain. I can send you in the conversation, I will send you in the conversation a document of 30 pages in English, giving you all the details on the future, the vision of the chair of geopolitics for 2023. So it will be easy for you, according to the continents in which you are, to read that in about 1 hour. And then this will give you one possible scenario for the coming year. But basically, we should focus on, yes, food, energy, inflation, Chinese-Russian, Indian connection. These are, I think, the main topics for the coming months. If we see further, if we look further away, of course, one of the big topics will be the succession, the political succession of Vladimir Putin. So I'm working at the current time at the history of imperial transitions, which are always times of instability, in order to analyze the historical elements which could help us anticipate this coming succession, but that's already in the middle, in a few years. And once, if you see this video in the replay, do not hesitate to contact the school and the chair if you want later more analysis, more informations, or do not hesitate to contact me directly on LinkedIn. With pleasure.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.